guys, some friends in a station wagon to play all over the world, and they ended up in Greece. And then they got sort of stuck there, and then they had to escape. And when he came back, he called John Mayall up and said, "Hey, can I have my job back?" John Mayall said, "Sure." So then he kicked out Peter Green. Y'all know Peter Green was the original guitar player in Fleetwood Mac. You see, Fleetwood Mac used to be a band that had no girls. You know, we're used to Stevie Nicks and et cetera in Fleetwood Mac. The original Fleetwood Mac, just a heavy blues band. If you want to hear some of that, there's some good stuff there. Okay. Anyway, after a while, still, he got sick of it. What happened? Ginger Baker, the drummer, was leaving his band, and he decided he wanted to go see Eric and get him to play. He sat in, he talked to him at the bar, and said, "Hey, you want to start a band?" And Eric says, "Yeah." And he says, who should we get to play bass? And Eric said, "Well, I want to play with Jack Bruce." Ginger Baker hated Jack Bruce. They used to be in the same band, and Ginger fired him one time, and Jack kept coming back, and finally Ginger pulled a knife on him and said, "Don't come back anymore, you get this." So now, but in order to get Eric Clapton, Ginger has to play in a band with Jack Bruce. So he had to go and ask Jack to join the band. He didn't bring a knife this time. And they did a truce, which for the musical world was probably one of the greatest truces in the history of the world, because they were only around for 2 or 3 years because Jack and Ginger started hating each other again. But man, the music they produced. And that's Disraeli Gears, an amazing album. They only created three or four original albums. And then there were some re-releases of live stuff, you know. All right, is this going to be cream? No, that's still...
No, it's going to be cream.
Oh, yeah, good. Anyway, they reunited in 2005, and I saw them. The greatest musical experience of my life. I almost cried. So. All right, and this is beautiful, too, although the filming is horrible. '60s, you know, that was supposed to look real trippy, and so you just shook the thing. Now, the problem is that dates horribly, and also it takes away from the impact of it, because this was their farewell concert where they announced, "We ain't playing anymore," and they did finally came back in 2005, which did not last long, because once again, Jack and Ginger started hating each other. Evidently, the day I saw them is when they started fighting again.
That's
all your fault, Ronald. It's
all your fault. And Ginger Baker is not a nice guy. A guy made a documentary about him, and the first scene you see Ginger's hitting the documentary maker with a cane, and he broke his nose. He said, told him, he says, if you don't shut up, I'm going to send you to the hospital. And he did. Now, I have conversed with Ginger on Facebook, and he's really nice to me. I'm sure if I saw him, he'd probably hit me, but that would be an honor to be hit by the greatest drummer ever. I mean, the guy's 70 years old, 70-some years old, and he plays better than most drummers than. When he was young, no one could touch him. Don't believe me? Go on to a song called Toad, and you will see a drum solo that's worth singing. Okay. Anyway, Cream breaks up, and the bass player Jack Bruce wrote a lot of their songs, and if you noticed, he wasn't just doing the boom, 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 basic bass line. He was playing bass like everybody else played guitar. In other words, he's playing lead lines with Eric Clapton. And by the way, Lynyrd Skynyrd played this same song, and it took three guitar players to play Eric Clapton's part. Three. Now he plays it slower version. That is a song, Crossroads, was written by a guy named Robert Johnson, who is very mysterious. And up until recently, there were no photos of Robert Johnson. Everybody was just guessing what he looked like. They finally found one or two. Robert Johnson died young. He was poisoned by a jealous husband. But he only wrote like 25, 26 songs. And Eric Clapton has recorded many of them. Now, Crossroads, the story behind it is Robert Johnson wanted to learn to play guitar. He started out and he wasn't very good. But according to legend, he went out on a crossroads and met the devil. And he made a deal with the devil so he could play guitar. That's the legend. And he died young. I think he was only 27. 27 is a bad age if you're a rock star. If you become a rock star, be very careful during 27. It's not good. Let me see. Brian Jones, the Rolling Stones, 27. Boom. Jimi Hendrix, I think, was 27. One of the Grateful Dead members who died was 27. I think Kurt Cobain might have been 27. Anyway, so be careful if you become a rock star and you get to be 27. Now that leads us to the 60s was a great time musically. It was a crazy time socially. And this is when you first start hearing a lot about drugs. As my mom used to say, there were no drugs. And that was, I never argued with my mom because then I'd hurt myself. I'd run right into that hand. Yeah. Then she goes, see, you hurt yourself. Yep, I ran right into that hand. I gotta be more careful, Mom.
I wasn't equal.
Anyway, and then, are you trying to get smart with me? And you don't say, well, would you rather me be stupid? Because then you're gonna meet the hand again. Now, you met the hand once, you didn't want to meet it again?
No.
Anyway, so what happened? Mom would say these wonderful sayings like, there were no drugs. Well, no, it's just people weren't open about them like they were then, like in the 60s, you know. There were drugs, people just weren't running around being open about it. Anyway, well.
You just talked about Billie Holiday, who was before all
of this. Oh, yeah, Billie Holiday, addicted to heroin.
That's right.
Etta James, who was another big blues vocalist, she was addicted to heroin. Heroin catches a lot of people. Ray Charles. Eric Clapton for a few years. It's evidently some really creative people feel the need to get extra stimulation. And so you gotta be careful, I guess. And no one starts out to be a heroin addict. You know, that's not on their to-do list. You know, yeah, I wanna go and get the shakes and hope I don't OD today. No, but what happens is they try and they go, well, it won't happen to me. But from what I understand, man, lots of people start and they can't stop. And Jimi Hendrix, heroin didn't do him in. It was sleeping pills. But Jimmy used everything in the pharmacy, as did many of the other people. Keith Richards did, and he's still alive. I tell you, if I ever needed blood transfusion, I want it from Keith Richards. Because it'll turn you into Superman. Because that man, he can do anything. Now, yeah, he can't talk very well, but daggone, he's the Energizer Bunny of human beings. You can't kill him. He wouldn't even have to duck and cover during a nuclear attack. Or get under the indestructible desk. All right, well anyway, Jimmy, did we have a Jimmy track?
I think it's later.
Oh, okay.
You did Bob Dylan, Garcia Band.
Okay, well Bob Dylan, now we get into the folky period, not one of my favorites. I'm not a big folky fan. But, you know, Bob influenced so many people. He writes good songs, he just can't sing. I mean, but he gives hope to those of us who can't sing. You know, you sit there and say, he's a millionaire and he sings, and you think, wow, maybe I could be too. Because he sings like, let me see, I always like to dig out my Bob Dylan imitation. I've been doing this imitation since high school.
Gosh,
just need attention. Oh, mama, can this really be the end? To be stuck inside a mobile with the Memphis Blues again. He's a millionaire. Okay, he writes some good songs. What I found is I usually enjoy other people's versions of his songs. People who can sing. I will never go see Bob, because from what I understand, now he sounds like he's gargling. And I don't want to see that. All right, are we going to show, oh yeah, this is my favorite Dylan song with his vocals. Knocking on Heaven's Door.
What? Part of his vocal quality can have a lot to do with that thing hanging out of his mouth. He performs with it.
This is a good song. This is my favorite Dylan song when he's singing. So imagine what the bad ones sound like. But some of his songs, as I say, are really good. They've been covered by many people. Hendrix did All Along the Watchtower. You've probably heard that. That's a Dylan song. You don't want to hear his version. Everybody else who's ever done that song does it better. As I say, that's the only original song I like. Now, the Grateful Dead and Jerry Garcia used to cover a lot of Dead songs. And Jerry Garcia said it because he said that these were songs that didn't make him feel silly when he sang them. You see, Jerry hated those corny, mushy love songs. And Bob Dylan may sing about love sometimes, but it's never corny and mushy. And so he said he could always do his songs without feeling, as I said, silly. And this is the Jerry Garcia Band, which was his solo play band. He, whenever the Dead didn't play, Jerry would go out and play. He just loved to play, and he probably needed the money because he used to spend it on drugs. And not a very good thing. This is Tangled Up in Blue, one of my favorite Dylan songs, done by somebody else. Lots of people, the keyboard player, he died in a car crash because the guy who was with him was driving while high. So there's a lot of casualties, and you know, we're left with a lot of might have beens. You know, like what would they have done if they would have kept going? You know, and people are always searching through the old, hoping to find some unreleased tracks. That's my favorite Dead song. Anyway, and the Grateful Dead, big in the 60s, but then in the 80s they had their first single hit, and then they got a whole new group of fans. And what happened then, it became incredibly hard to get tickets. I know I really struggled to get tickets when I went. I went 5 times. And but they were sort of musical Russian roulette. Some days they would be amazingly good, and some days they would be god-awful. And you just hoped you were there for the good ones. And also, they would play different sets. So you always hoped they didn't play your favorite song the night before. Because if they did, they weren't going to play it 2 days in a row. Matter of fact, I saw them 5 times. They never played Boxer Rain. You know, I'd always ask somebody who was at the show before, and usually what happened, they played it the day before. Because they usually play the same venue for like 2 or 3 days, because the demand was so amazing. People would also follow them.
Deadheads
would follow them. I had a chance one time to follow them one summer. North Carolina Charlotte was teaching a class called The Sociology of Grateful Dead. And somebody sent me a brochure, but it would cost thousands of dollars. But they would put us on a bus, and you would have watched the entire summer tour, but you had to write a paper about your experience, which would have been interesting, writing a paper about Deadheads and the music and God knows what. So I didn't have $2,000 at that stage of the game, so I did not follow them all over the country. But anyway, this is my favorite Dead song, Box of Rain, and my advice to you, this is from 86, which is not a bad year for the Dead. Once again, people will argue. You talk to Deadheads, they'll argue about what the best show is, what the best year tour is. My 2 cents worth on that is, get tour, if you want to get a show, get something from 73, I think the 73 shows are the best.